So good morning, everyone. Good morning, respected delegates, doctors, and faculty members. This is Shivani, your hall coordinator, and welcome to the 79th AIOC Conference 2021. To get the session started, I would request the chairpersons to please unmute the mic and switch on the camera, starting with Dr. Sarpal Kamal Saroop, Dr. Samantha Swapan Kumar, Co-Chairman Dr. Arun Sethi, Co-Chairman Dr. Sambhuda Ghosh, Convener Dr. R.B. Goyal, Co-Convener Dr. Arup Chakrabarti, Moderator Dr. Praveen Vyavare.
Yes, Dr. Bhosle, are you ready now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you can start.
Sir, speaker ke liye time kitna dena hai?
Speaker, 6 minutes is the time for the presentation and 2 minutes for the discussion.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Should I start, sir?
Yes, you can start.
Good morning, all delegates and respected seniors. I'm Dr. Dhananjay Bhosle. And thanks to AOS for giving me opportunity to present this. I'm Dr. Dhananjay Bhosle, working as a junior resident in the Department of Ophthalmology in the PGIYCMH, Pimpri. My topic is Community Eye Hospital, a novel green campus combating the carbon footprinting. Sir, I am having no financial interest and no conflicts of interest. Sir, in the background, the global warming is one of the largest threat in the 21st century. And our health facility is one of the main contributor in the carbon emission leading to this global warming. Under this study, I am going to assess the footprinting of carbon footprint of our tertiary eye care institute and tackling the same that carbon footprinting with the green cover present in our hospital campus. Sir, it is a retrospective study conducted during the 1 year span to assess the carbon footprinting at our hospital undergoing cataract surgery at the Shankara Hospital, Coimbatore, sir. Under this study, first of all, sir, I calculated the carbon emission, that is carbon equivalent, during the surgical procedure. Most of the, them are SICS. And then the study major, I am also studying the study measures to counteract the this carbon emission produced during the carbon emission by our hospital green cover, sir. In the first study, I have estimated, sir, the carbon equivalent by the following way: list of materials used during the SICS procedure, which includes, sir, drapes, syringes, plastic derivatives, even our disposable surgical instruments, papers, ink, drugs, where the estimated they were weighted, and the estimated lifespan along with the weight of each tool and the surgical instrument was measured individually, and the CO2 equivalent produced was calculated using the CO2 equivalent calculator online available. And after getting all the CO2 equivalent per surgery, I estimated the carbon absorbed by our green cover around our hospital. The number of trees and the green cover present in our hospital was evaluated, and the CO2 consumed by them was compared in a whole, and its environmental implication was studied. During this study, I found that, sir, 1 ton of carbon storage in a tree would represent removal of, sir, 3.67 tons of CO2 from the atmosphere, and with release of 2.67 tons of oxygen into the atmosphere. Sir, biomass assessment illustrates the amount of carbon that may be sequestered by the tree as an important indicator in the estimating carbon sequestration. Sir, here approximately, according to papers present online, 50% of the dry biomass comprising of a carbon was used to calculate the consumed by our tree. एज ए ट्री कन्वर्ट कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड इनटू द सर पॉलीसैकेराइड्स और शुगर एंड मोस्ट ऑफ वेट ऑफ द शुगर इज कंट्रीब्यूटेड in our green cover hospital we are having sir 55 fully grown trees which include peepal trees rain trees flame of the forest trees ashoka trees and jackfruit trees 100 coconut trees are covering outer periphery and 200 nearly 200 ornamental plants various ornamental plants are present there we have implemented Miyawaki method of plantation which is a different in the during the Miyawaki this Miyawaki method we plant trees more compactly it will they will grow 30% more denser and go at the rate of 10% faster in this result I found that during the each SICS procedure till the discharge the waste generated per patient was sir 310 grams and this 310 gram resulted in the total release of 3.2 kilogram of CO2 equivalents in the atmosphere the cumul and this is a sir CO2 equivalent discharged by our hospital during our green plant fixed this by consuming 1.33.22 tons of CO2 thus by having green cover around our hospital we are absorbing more carbon equivalents than we have released during the SICS surgical in the community based approach here we are operating 32,000 to 33,000 patients but at the same time we are absorbing 133 tons of CO2 which is a helping environment and improving the environment facility by absorbing the released carbon dioxide sir this is our hospital photo sir thank you sir
nice Dr. Bhosle you have finished on time I just wanted to ask you whether you have compared the carbon for the SICS compared to the FACO or only you have analyzed this SICS surgery
sir actually this is a community based hospital sir and we are operating 32,000 of patient most of them are sir SICS of course sir some FACO patients are there but mostly I have considered sir SICS patients as a FACO calculation is little bit complex sir as electricity is also going to get consumed during the FACO procedures disposable atoms used are more and during the SICS procedure sir we can decrease the carbon output by reusing means we can avoid the drip by using the towels we can sir at our hospital we are using one Raja blade that blade is can be used for incision even it work as a crescent even it work as a side port sir by single piece of nearly 1 gram of metal we are eliminating that crescent keratomes and side ports thus decreasing the disposable atom load sir this study most of I have used SICS and the FACO study is underway sir means due to the complexity I am doing on it sir
The other thing I wanted to ask is that this is a very important topic because we have so many of our centers which are located in metros where planting of trees and greenery is impossible. Now, how do these centers give back to the community, to the environment that you are doing through trees and all that? Is there any other method of doing this?
Sir, these centers can use the sir means decrease the that disposable item use. Means like I said, sir, we can eliminate crescent, keratome, and side port by using a single instrument. Means that plastic load means single metal instrument. Plastic load will be decreased, sir. Instead of using eye drips, we can use a two eye towel well autoclaved. Then, sir, means. And even environmental friendly with the less press they can use that Miyawaki press technique of plantation which will give more carbon dioxide taking and auto output.
So basically, what we are preaching is that we go back from the consumables to the re-renewables.
Yes, sir.
Very interesting. Right, the time is up now, so we can invite the next speaker.
I think Dr. Radhika Krishnan is there, or she is yet to log in. Dr. Kamrul Khan, you can present now then.
Yes, thank you, sir. Let me share my screen.
What is the number?
FP2177, right?
Okay.
Is it visible now? Can you see my screen, please?
Yes, yes, go on.
Respected chairpersons, the audience, ladies and gentlemen, I welcome you all on my today's presentation on shedding of COVID-19 virus in tears and conjunctival secretion in a pandemic situation. Myself, Brigadier General Kamrul Khan, I am working as a HOD in the Combined Military Hospital, Dhaka. I don't have any financial conflict. These are the staffs. I acknowledge their contribution. Staffs of my department, the pulmonologist, the microbiologist, and team Combined Military Hospital. Background of the objective: in December 2019, an outbreak of novel coronavirus, COVID-19, emerged in Wuhan, China, and has quickly spread throughout the world. Novel coronavirus strain may produce conjunctival inflammation and can be detected in tears and conjunctival secretions. Coronavirus had been previously reported to be associated with conjunctivitis in humans. Retinal disorders such as retinal vasculitis, retinal degenerations, non-retinal barrier breakdown had been demonstrated in experimental animal models. And implications in there is that there may be a potential hazard to the healthcare workers, especially the ophthalmologists who perform examinations in close proximity to COVID-19 patients and may come in contact with the tears and conjunctival secretions. COVID-19 is a highly contagious disease, capable of progression to acute respiratory distress syndrome, even death. The infectious agent of this disease entity is caused by a novel coronavirus, severe acute respiratory distress syndrome coronavirus, that is SARS-CoV-2. In March 2020, the first case of COVID-19 was detected in Bangladesh, and day by day it had been increasing. Along with the nasopharyngeal swab, conjunctival secretion may also become a spread of source of infection, and it may be potential route to transmit to other people also. So we undertook this interventional study to examine conjunctival swab for presence of SARS-CoV-2 RNA and determine whether a correlation existed between systemic COVID-19 infections with shedding of it through the conjunctival secretion. Ocular complications of SARS-CoV-2 infection have not been widely reported. Viral loads in ocular tissue are still to be investigated. In our country, the number of COVID-19 patients are growing almost alarmingly high. So conjunctival diagnosis may be a tool for early detection and better planning to stop transmissions through population chain. Currently, our understanding of possible ocular complication of SARS-CoV-2 infection is very limited. A retrospective study tested conjunctival samples for SARS-CoV-2 RNA in 30 infected patients, and conjunctival samples were from one patient who were positive for the virus on third day. The fact that their patients developed acute viral conjunctivitis with positive SARS-CoV-2 tests in conjunctival swab samples indicated that SARS-CoV-2 could indeed cause complication, but not necessarily in the same stage of the illness. Zhou, Y et al. Described in their study that of 121 patients with confirmed COVID-19, 63 patients had mild or moderate disease, 53 patients had severe or critical disease. The mean standard deviation of the duration of the disease was 15 days. 8 patients showed ocular symptoms. Only one of them showed positive results for SARS-CoV-2 in the conjunctiva. Wu, P, et al. Described they have recruited 38 consecutive patients with COVID-19 positive. 28 patients had positive findings for COVID-19 on RNA-PCR from nasopharyngeal swab, and of these, 2 patients yielded positive findings. Conjunctival swab specimen remained positive SARS-CoV-2 on 14 and 17 days after onset. On day 19, RT result was negative. Chen Liu et al. Narrated a case report with slit lamp finding. Slit lamp examination revealed bilateral acute follicular conjunctivitis, but they don't find any RT-PCR positive in conjunctival secretion. Our patients, our type of study was a prospective interventional study. Place was Combined Military Hospital, Dhaka. Period of study was May 2020 to June 2020. Study population confirmed COVID-19 patients admitted in corona dedicated ward of Combined Military Hospital, Dhaka. The patient with COVID-19 positive aged between 1 year to 90 years, and the exclusion was patients with a history of pneumonia, tuberculosis, COPD, uveitis, and history of recent ocular allergy. This patient was excluded. But for infrastructure and key constant, only 20 eyes was included in the study. Sampling technique was randomized and non-purposive. Patient under study was explained in details about the disease process, benefits of evaluation, and methods and risk of evaluation technique. Written consent was taken, maintaining the principle of health. A total of 20 eyes of 20 patients randomly was selected, and unfortunately or fortunately, we did not find any single positive cases of COVID-19 from the nasopharyngeal swab. In presence of SARS-CoV-2, RNA was detected by real-time RT-PCR in Armed Forces Institute of Pathology and maintaining the all the protocols of international review. None of the cases we find the COVID-19 positive. There was no positive cases. COVID-19 illness can range associated to mild to severe respiratory distress. An ophthalmologist was first to report the virus in Wuhan, himself contracted and succumbed to death. Ophthalmic manifestations are varied in terms of presentation, severity, and timing. So shedding of COVID-19 virus was not found in tear or conjunctival secretion. Still, protection is essential due to unknown extension of the corona effect. Proper safety and protection with scientific protocol will help you help to continue daily essential activities. Thank you very much. These are the references.
Thank you, Dr. Abdul Khan. Do we have any questions?
Yeah, sorry, go ahead.
Now, I have a question. In fact, a couple of questions. What was the type of randomization? He said that Dr. Khan said that the randomization was done. So, how was the patients randomized? And secondly, what was the time gap between the RT-PCR positivity by throat swab and the conjunctival swab?
Thank you very much for asking the questions. Actually, we decided to go for initially a big number of cases to be tested, but I have already mentioned due to time constraint and as well as the constraint of our kits, we ultimately restricted only 20 patients, but we did not go for any particular specific type of patient. We have just taken the sample who are COVID positive and admitted in the hospital, and we usually took the sample twice. First, just after admission in the hospital, we have taken the nasal sample, and after 7 days, we have taken another sample. This was our study system.
The question that I wanted to ask you was that in your study, in the patients who were negative with the conjunctival and the tear drop study and were positive in the RT-PCR study, how many of them actually turned out and went to a stage where they needed to go on a ventilator or something like that? Was there any correlation between the severity of conjunctivitis and the patients who went on ventilator?
Actually, this study, some of the cases, there was no at all conjunctivitis. We just studied only those patients who were COVID positive, admitted in the hospital. We have taken sample whether there is any COVID-19 virus present in the conjunctival tears or secretion or not. Just
you showed slides of patients with conjunctival congestion.
Yes.
That's why I asked this question.
Yes, few of the cases we found conjunctivitis and not related even with our this study. We get some of the cases who are not included in our study. We have shown the slide that COVID-19 positive patients has reported to us with conjunctivitis in different forms, with a mild varieties up to a very severe one. But in our study population, among those 20, only two patients we had conjunctivitis, and that was only of a very mild form.
Thank you very much, Doctor. Welcome to AIOC. Enjoy the conference. We move on to our next speaker now.
Thank you very much.
Dr. Radhika Krishna is not here, I think. Dr. Vanshaj Rai, not present. Dr. Balakrishna Samantarai. Dr. Balakrishna,
yes,
you
sir.
Are there?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, I am there.
Yeah, you can present now.
Sir, is my screen being shared?
Yes.
Shall I start now, sir?
Yes.
Go ahead.
Good morning to respected chairperson, sir, and esteemed faculties. Myself, Dr. Balakrishna Samantarai, Assistant Professor, SV Medical College, Cuttack, Odisha. My paper is Establishing Retinopathy of Prematurity Care Model in Government Newborn Care Unit with public-private partnership mode are experienced in Eastern India. There is no financial interest. Retinopathy of prematurity is a proliferative retinopathy affecting immature retinal vasculature. It accounts for 3.5 to 18% of all childhood blindness. Three crucial risk factors are low birth weight, low gestational age, and number of days of oxygen administration, and other risk factors contribute to the retinopathy of prematurity. It is no more restricted to metro cities. The severity and incidence depends on the postnatal care, so varies from unit to unit. ROP is rising in epidemic proportion in Odisha, and our institute is no exception to it. My study location is SCB Medical College, Cuttack. Period of study is March 2017 to September 2019, a 2.5-year cross-sectional prospective study. The purpose of my study is to establish independent ROP care in government setup with public-private partnership. Queen with the funding of Queen Elizabeth Trust UK, ROP project was launched in 5 districts of Odisha, and a memorandum of understanding was signed between the state government of Odisha and LV Prasad Eye Institute Bhubaneswar, which acted as a partnering private setup as mentor and training institute. Public Health Foundation of India PHFI Hyderabad and Rashtriya Bal Swasthya Karyakram under National Health Mission supported the activity and its implementation. Training of two ophthalmologists from SCB Medical College was done regarding the ROP screening and management, like laser and IV intravitreal anti-VEGF injection. The partnering institute, LV Prasad Eye Hospital, did the training at the mentors institute. And after the completion of the training, on-site supervision and distant monitoring was done in our institute, so that the effective and regular systematic ROP screening and management was possible, which was not there before 2016. Equipments and all supplied by Government of Odisha and RBSK and PHFI were RedCam, laser, and intraophthalmoscope and lenses. That we analyzed the data in terms of impact and outcomes of the program in terms of capacity building, patient care, quality improvement, and coordination between the government and mentors institute. Our journey started at our institute, SCB, LV Prasad, PHFI, and RBSK collaboration. We maintained all the protocols. Our inclusion criteria was any baby with gestational age less than 34 weeks, and or any baby with birth weight less than equal to 2 kg, or any higher gestational age with associated risk factor and a STORMI neonatal course. We did all the screening at the bedside in SNCU and NICUs. To our advantage, we have RedCam for photo documentation. The primary modality of treatment was laser, and an alternative mode of treatment was also anti-VEGF. With all protocols and asepsis maintained, it was done at the bedside. Our result, total number of baby screened is 15,528, out of which 601 were reported to have ROP of some degree, that was 39%. Treatment modalities were laser in 67 baby, anti-VEGF in 8, anti-VEGF plus laser in 5. Total babies treated were 80. That accounts to 5.2% of all ROPs. Total babies recovered were 68. Lost to follow-up were 8, and total baby worsened were 4. But we are able to save 130 eyes from being blind. the results in terms of capacity building prior to 2016, there was no systematic RRP screening at our institute, but after screening, after the training, it was made possible by our own faculty. Outcome of our model, coordination and good network buildup between the government and private public partners, advocacy in the neonatal care, the CM, organization of CMEs and workshops at our site, the supervision by the PHFI team, and the international mentors, our coordination between the pediatrician, the, the nurses.
Hello.
Hello.
Good morning, everybody.
We are in the middle of a presentation, sir.
Yeah.
Please, please mute your mic.
Documentation, proper documentation, and creation of our own WhatsApp group for coordination among all. Discussion. The ophthalmologist in medical colleges can be trained in ROP screening, laser, and injection. It has a learning curve. It needs practice, thorough practice before perfection. This model ensures skilled ROP care at the bedside because improvement of ROP care is a good reflection of good neonatal care. To conclude, PPP mode, a public-private partnership mode of ROP care model is effective and sustainable. It can be replicable in peripheral districts for a wide coverage. It can be a role model for independent buildup of ROP care in any part of the country to prevent the ROP-related blindness. This is my reference. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Samantre.
Very well done and very well presented, and interesting to see how many eyes were saved. I think this is something which should be taken forward in terms of partnership, because this is a very major source of blindness in your needs.
Hello.
So, Dr. Balkrishna, before the 2016 and after implementing your model, so have you find that significant difference in the care, the quality of care you have taken? And was there any care before 2016?
Sir, before 2016, there was some amount of care being given by a local private hospital, but it was not systematic. It was not fixed days of a week. We started twice a week screening. We started in our own government setup, we started treatment free of cost, but the private setup, they had were taking the treatment with cost, but the RBSK did a great job. The Rashtriya Bal Swasthya Karyakram did a great job. It made all the treatment possible by its state government. So laser and anti-VEGF injection at the site are all done free of cost. There is a substantial increase in the patient care. There is substantial improvement in the patient care, and ROP has come down.
So have you included the private practitioner in that area also in this study?
No, sir. Only the mentoring institute is helping us. Was being helping us for 1 year, then it stopped. I mean, for timely they are being called. But this is our own government setup. So after that, no private people are coming. After we taken over the charge.
I'd be interested to know as to how do you give intravitreal IVGF in these units? Do you have the kind of anesthesia facilities in the hospital?
Sir, we are doing everything under topical anesthesia, sir, because we are doing it on the bedside. They are extremely sick babies, not able to sit. Hello?
Yeah, go ahead.
Because we are extremely sick babies, we are doing it under topical anesthesia at the bedside itself. We are maintaining all the asepsis, and we are doing and injecting the anti-VEGF at the site itself. And after that,
this is under topical anesthesia.
This is topical anesthesia.
Yes. This should be reported as one of the few cases I've known where you can give anti-VEGF under topical anesthesia in units. What is your opinion about this, Dr. Vashish?
Yes, sir.
In RP center, how are you doing this? Are you doing it under topical anesthesia or are you doing this under GI?
I'm not aware, sir. Actually, that's not my pass. Thank you. Sorry.
Sir, since we had trained, this is the mode of anesthesia we had been trained. That is why we are doing it. And because it is difficult to shift them to our OT. Because the
I understand the point. I just want to know. Because getting a child to cooperate also is not easy.
Yes.
And the next speaker, Dr. Praveen.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, actually, I think Dr. Praveen Vasista is there, right?
Yeah.
You can go now.
I hope my slides are visible.
Yes, it's visible.
Yes.
Thank you very much, judges. I'll be talking about National Survey on Human Resource and Infrastructure for Eye Care Service in India. The survey was led by RP Center, and we are very fortunate that we got the best partners in this National Program for Control of Blindness and Visual Impairment, All India Ophthalmic Society, Vision 2020 Right to Sight, and was sponsored by Orbis. You know, as a background, when Vision 2020 Right to Sight India was launched in 2004, there we targeted that by 2020, we should have 25,000 ophthalmologists in country and around 48,000 hospital-based paramedics who are supporting in those ophthalmologists in hospitals. And beside this, as for infrastructure, we plan for around 2,200 service center, training centers at a secondary level and above. And the aim of this current study to assess the current status of human resource and infrastructure in our country, India. And for this, the objective or cap is to obtain an estimate of number of eye care institute services along with the ophthalmologists and optometrists available in India, plus linking this database to India Vision Atlas, which was developed by RP Center for NPC, and which is a public web portal with easy access for patient as well as for the policymakers. For this, we were expecting a list of institute, but there was no such list available. So what we decided that we got the database from AIS, that was ophthalmologist was data, and also database from NIC district portals, from Ayushman Bharat directories, from website of various hospitals, and ultimately developed the detailed list of all eye care institute in India. A team of 30 staff members from Community Ophthalmology RP Center were. Luckily, we used that corona time that all the staff are available for this work, and each staff was given responsibility for one or two states, and they were located based on their knowledge about the local language, etc. And in the first phase, what we did is the entire list which we got, we collected information from secondary and tertiary level eye care facilities. The condition was that at least full-time or part-time ophthalmologist should be available in this center. And we use this online questionnaire portal using www.surveymonkey.com. And using this portal, we requested all the institute to fill this questionnaire either through email or through WhatsApp or through direct interviews. After the first phase, we had virtual meeting with all the state program officers of different states and UTs in India and with their DPOs. Luckily, this virtual team program is so good that we saved a lot of time. And there was full involvement of principal consultant from NPCB and NVI for this program. The respective state coordinators from RP Center, they coordinated with each and every institute. They ensured the data cleaning and validation. We also submitted the data back to the institute for confirmation whether it is right or wrong. As a result, I'm sharing that out of total 9,440 institute listed, we are able to contact 8,790 eye care institute. And among them, 7901, 90% people, they submitted their data. This is such a huge, good, positive response. Against a target of 2,200 institute, we were able to say that in India, there are around 7,901 institute who are providing secondary level services through their ophthalmologists. If you see the ownership, the private sector is probably the highest number. It is 70.6% is there. After that, it is public sector 15.6 and NGOs 13.8%. Type of services, it is operation theater facilities are available in 87%. We got emergency, eye bank, refractive surgery, and low vision service details. And as for the subspecialty, it is mainly the cataract and glaucoma, but there are squint, VR, keratoplasty, oculoplasty, and neuro-ophthalmic services are also available. We developed 5 indicators after discussion with the ministry, AIOS, and Vision 2020. These indicators were eye institute population ratio, ophthalmologist population ratio, optometrist or ophthalmic assistant per institute ratio, and also indicated like pediatric eye institute population ratio, pediatric ophthalmologist population ratio. These indicators were developed for entire country, India, for every state, and in fact, every district. Recently, WHO eye care situation analysis tool was filled by us, and we use this survey data for purpose of filling this. These are like ISU population ratio. You can see we have a color coding indicator for each state. In India, we have one institute per 1,64,536 population. This is ophthalmologist population ratio. One ophthalmologist per 65 to one population against a target of 1 per 50,000 population. So 20,944 ophthalmologists reported for this thing, and color coding is showing which state has the maximum. It's the Maharashtra, Telangana, Haryana, Uttarakhand, and Delhi has the maximum number of ophthalmologists. Optometrist or ophthalmic assistant per institute, this ratio is 2.26 per institute. Total 17,856 optometrists or ophthalmic assistant were reported. Again, pediatric institute, similar indicator. In fact, can develop hundreds of such indicators. Pediatric ophthalmologist population ratio, all these are there. The second component was it should be accessible to everyone. So we link this with India Vision Atlas. aims.education.edu. So this vision atlas was developed by RP Center. It was initially used for National Blindness Survey, Blindness and Visual Impairment Survey. And now we have it for this data also. Every week we can see all the data, etc. in this vision atlas. Even the district-wise details can be seen. And even every patient, every person can look filter this each and every institute's district ownership facilities through this thing and go into this thing. This is something special that everyone can use, they can download, they can see the services available in every district in the country. And it is linked with Google also, so anyone can go through Google to the respective institute. To summarize this Vision Atlas, the Vision Atlas is planned with a dynamic database that prints every time it can be periodically updated. If the institute are sending their information data to us, Vision Atlas provide information up to district level planning and infrastructure needs. And in fact, all policy makers and planners can use it for their respective districts. Even the layperson can use it for accessibility of the services available in their district. To summarize, the reported ophthalmologists are 20,944. It is lesser than that we targeted 25,000 ophthalmologists. Reported optometrists are 1786. They are, we needed 48,000. And there is need to give focus on northeastern, eastern, and northern part of the country, south and western part of the country. I'm really thankful. I'm acknowledging all the people who supported us for this survey. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Vasish. I just give a feedback that 6 minutes is very less time for such topics. The previous schedule of 8 minutes was good. Anyhow, good morning, Dr. Sethi.
Good morning, Dr. Goyal. So I think it is a very comprehensive, well-intentioned presentation to know what is happening at the ground level. And it also goes to show that a lot can be done if we bring in the private sector into community ophthalmology. So we leave it to Dr. Vasheer to work on that, because this is something which is already bothering me, that we are underutilized in the private sector. There is so much of a backlog in the blindness that why doesn't somebody do to bring the two together? Make it more worthwhile of a private practitioner to be involved in community ophthalmology. It will make a lot of difference. And as explained by Dr. G. M. Rao in the previous conference, that vision centers should be more and tertiary centers can gradually be respected. Thank you very much.
Sorry to interrupt.
I'm agreeing with Dr. Spiti about this thing. Just suggest one.
Okay.
75% of the eye care is through private sector. So it is extremely important that they should be involved in community ophthalmology in strengthening eye care service in the country. You're very right.
So I would suggest that some method be found to bring the two together. One of the things you were there in the Vision 2020 program was that all AIOS members should be co-opted as members of Vision 2020 and vice versa at a very nominal charge, so that you could have thousands of ophthalmologists, not voting members, but non-voting members, who could put their inputs and take Vision 2020 to much higher level than what it is today.
And I'll try to give this message to Vision 2020 right to say, yes.
Yes, Dr. Goyal.
Yes.
You were saying something?
No, sir.
So who's the next speaker now, Dr.?
Dr. Praveen, I wanted to ask you one question. When you looked at the distribution of the ophthalmologists all over Pan India, so can you highlight what are the things where it is less number of ophthalmologists in that particular state? And this is very helpful for the private ophthalmologists who are going to start their practice.
Thank you, Dr. Praveen. In fact, not only state, we have gone up to district level. We are ready to give planning for each and every district for the country. But broadly, if you see, as I mentioned, it is number of ophthalmologists are sufficient in southern India as well as the western part of India. And they're grossly lacking in northeast and eastern part and northern part of India. Probably we need to give more emphasis in this part of the country.
You see, I was involved in a discussion 3 days ago with the organizer, Mr. Daniel of India Vision Institute. And it was very interesting that I had suggested to them that, you know, the vision centers that we have, they're quite evenly spread compared to the tertiary eye centers. Obviously, yes. If vision centers all over could be with some sort of a government grant and private-public partnership, be upgraded to a level where an ophthalmologist could go there, say, once a week and operate on cataract patients right there, in the SICS board, you'll find that the number of patients for the private practitioner who goes there once a week will rise up. He will get some compensation in the form of 2,000 or whatever they give per cataract. The vision center will be known more rather than just a center for referral to the base hospital. And the entire dynamics of ophthalmology and practice today can undergo a change in the next 5 years. And this is something which is worth looking at. Why should we use vision centers only to transmit photographs and then tell them, now please go to the base hospital? COVID has shown that collecting people in one spot is not a good idea. So we need to decentralize the way we are practicing ophthalmology today. Rather, I would say, I was in a World Association of Eye Hospital meeting last year, before the COVID came, and they were already discussing in Europe to create eye facilities where a patient does not need to visit the hospital. You look at the thinking of the Dutch. They are building a hospital in the Rotterdam, which will cater to less than 5% of the patients who need eye care, because most of it they'll go through teleophthalmology,
also very few centers. I would like to give a comment on this thing. We already have nearly 8,000 secondary level centers. Then vision center, we don't have OT facilities in vision centers.
We have to create them. We have to create them in a basic way. I'm just saying they are required.
7,009 number is such a huge number against a target of 2,200 that we have the sufficient facilities available. We need to increase the number of surgeries in these centers. Right.
But have you noticed one thing very interesting, that RP center has been shut for OPD services for quite some time. And it has made no impact on the incidence of blindness. What does that show? It shows that the country can function without an RP center for a particular period of time. I'm not trying to put down RP center. What I'm trying to say is that today ophthalmology is so well developed in metros that you are able to take over the workload of other hospitals without understanding. Like GNET has been shut for so many months. Shirov Charity Eye Hospital reported an increase of 80% in those 3 months of services where patients shifted from GNEC to Shirov Charity. It's interesting to see that COVID has brought up so many parameters that you can actually do. If you actually shut down a hospital, people are forced to find alternate ways, and those alternate ways sometimes work.
So we are looking forward to see the impact of COVID on blindness. We have the pre-COVID data, and in fact, if we can try post-COVID also, we can see the impact, because the total number of cataract surgeries reduced to nearly 50% at the national level, 65 lakh to 35 lakhs due to COVID in 2020. Thank you, sir. Thank
you. That's an interesting figure to see. Well, not only COVID, cataract, which is elective surgery. I was talking to the chief of Medanta, the Medicity. Their cardiac surgeries during COVID has dropped by 90%. But the question is cardiac surgery an emergency surgery or elective surgery? You know, it's a very interesting phenomenon. Non-COVID hospitals are having no occupancy. They are facing financial disasters. They are for sale. Patients are not coming to hospitals. Yet, you find that a lot of thought needs to go into it, that does the patient need the hospital or does the hospital need the patient? Which stage are we in?
I'm extremely sorry, sir, to interrupt, but we are running out of time. Can you please move to the next speaker?
Thank
also, Dr. Praveen, Rasika had some confusion, and because of which she was not able to present in the last session. She's requesting if she can present in this one.
We can keep her last. If the time permits, then we can accommodate her. But we don't have anything deep. We can send the marks.
So let us please stand by. Dr. Praveen will take a call at this time.
Right.
So she should not leave the room.
Okay. Now the next speaker, Dr. Radhika, is still there. She is still absent, I think. Dr. Vanshaj, Raj, no. Dr. Abhilasha Maheshwari. I cannot see your name. Dr. Bishnu Priya Kuntia. Dr. Bishnu Priya. And one another keynote address. A lot of speakers are absent.
There are hardly any speakers.
Any speaker?
Only three speakers.
Yeah, only we have finished only four.
Should have taken more time.
So we can have a discussion. Why don't we allow this lady to speak now?
Yeah, we can.
Please ask her to come on and present. Is she ready to present? Slides are loaded.
Shivani, is she ready to present?
Rasika.
Dr. Rasika, are you ready to present?
Yes, ma'am, I'm ready to present.
Please explain your topic because it's not distinct.
Yeah, actually, we don't have the topic, the name of the topic. And tell your free paper number also.
She's Dr. Radhika.
Rasika.
She's Dr. Radhika.
Rasika.
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 She's not in the list, sir. She's not in the list because she's from the other group. And we are accepting her because being a community, you think we have to be community minded.
So should I tell
Please
my...
go ahead.
So free paper number 1720.
1720, okay.
Selective laser trabeculoplasty compared to topical drug as a primary therapy in open angle.
Okay, go on, Rasika. Share your screen.
Thank you so much, sir. So, is it visible?
Yeah. Yes.
Good morning, everyone. Today, I'll be presenting a study titled Selective Laser Trabeculoplasty compared to topical anti-glaucoma medication as a primary therapy in open angle glaucoma. I have no financial disclosure and no conflicts of interest. Glaucoma is a leading cause of blindness worldwide, with around 80 million people worldwide and about 12 million people in India. Among all the risk factors, intraocular pressure is the most important modifiable and treatable risk factor. Conventionally, medical therapy has been practiced as a primary therapy. However, long-term usage of drugs is associated with multiple adverse effects, high pharmaceutical cost of eye drops leading to financial burden on patients, and non-compliance to therapy. So there is a need to assess for some alternative therapy and see the efficacy of laser as a primary modality. Aim of the disease was to compare the efficacy of selective laser trabeculoplasty with conventional anti-glaucoma medication as primary therapy in open-angle glaucoma. Methodology. This was a prospective randomized clinical trial carried out at tertiary eye care center. Cases considered were primary open-angle glaucoma, pseudo-exfoliative glaucoma, and ocular hypertension. They underwent thorough examination like visual function assessment, slit lamp examination, applanation tonometry, pachymetry, gonioscopy, optic map head examination, 90 diopter lens, and standard automatic perimetry with complex field analyzer. And based on the Herdapp-Perchand-Anderson's criteria, they were classified as mild, moderate, severe cases. Patients in the age group of 18 to 70 years with the IOP ranging 21 to 30 millimeter of mercury and central corneal thickness less than 100 microns were included in the study. Whereas patients having ocular comorbidity or having undergone any ocular surgery, laser, topical anti-glaucoma medication, or any systemic drugs known to influence IOP were excluded from the study. Similarly, one-eye patients and severe glaucoma patients were also excluded from the study. After having explained the study design and taking informed consent, 65 eyes were considered for study. They were randomly allocated to two groups, one medication and other SLT. Target IOP was arbitrarily decided at the presentation, such as to achieve 20 to 30% decline from baseline IOP. They were followed up at 1 week, 1 month, 3 months, 6 months, and 12 months. At any point of visit, if inadequate response to treatment was found, patients in the AGM were given alternate AGM, and patients in SLT were augmented with second wave of SLT. Further, if still inadequate response, AGM was added to either of the groups. Results. Out of 65 eyes, 54 eyes completed 1 year follow-up with 26 eyes in AGM and 20 in SLT. 25 were males, 29 were females, with a mean age of 56.18 plus minus 10 years. About glaucoma distribution, in AGM group, we had 14 cases of primary open angle glaucoma, 7 of pseudo-exfoliative glaucoma, and 5 of ocular hypertension. In SLT group, 16 cases were of primary open angle glaucoma, 8 of PXG, and 4 of ocular hypertension. So there was no significant difference in terms of age, gender, and type of glaucoma. This diagram depicts the trend of IOP decline. is 27.07 millimeter of mercury in medication arm and 26 in SLT arm, the difference being statistically not significant. It was found that UV control was comparable in both the arms in the early period, but effect of SLT started waning off in the later period. And good number of cases in SLT required addition of augmentation of SLT and even additional AGM. Thus, at the end of 1 year, IOP decline in SLT group was 28.56%, whereas in medication group, it was 40.64%, which is statistically significant. Considering the AGM arm, out of 26 eyes, almost 11 eyes managed to have good IOP control with just one AGM, whereas 15 eyes required additional AGM. Baseline number of drugs started in the 26 eyes was 1.74 mean, and wherever required, mean 1.2 number of drugs were added. This final AGM coming out to be 2.94. Whereas in SLT group, out of 28 eyes, 9 eyes had a good IOP control with single sitting of SLT, 13 eyes required second sitting of SLT, whereas 6 eyes required additional AGM. But here, additional AGM was just 1.4 in contrast to 2.94 in the AGM group. Thus, we can see how SLT has improved the polypharmacy in the glaucoma patients. So coming to the discussion, AGM is associated with
Nandra.
Of pigmented trabecular meshwork. Complications with SLT are transient and self-limited, which disappear within 24 hours without intervening. It's also found gonioscopy done at 1 year has shown no structural changes, and hence it indicates the safety and repeatability of SLT. Several studies have been done with the same study purpose, showing IOP decline 26 to 35% from baseline. A few study to quote would be study by Angius et al. Done over 24 months showed IOP decline, which was 18.6% higher in medication group as compared to SLT, like similar to our study. In contrast to that, in study done by Lai et al., no significant difference was found in the IOP decline between AGM group and SLT group at 5 year follow-up. So conclusion would be, like, even though the IOP reduction is greater in medication group and it has been used as a primary therapy, SLT has still shown good IOP control by achieving the target IOP. Hence, it can definitely be used as a primary therapy in patients, more so in patients non-compliant to medication and contraindicated for surgery. In addition to that, SLT has reduced the mean number of AGM required for glaucoma patients, thus reducing the associated adverse effects and also reducing the financial burden. One more point going in favor of SLT is that even though if it doesn't achieve the target IOP in first sitting, considering the melanin target tissue sparing mechanism of SLT, it is safely repeatable procedure. Thus, it is a single intervention with not ongoing patient compliance, it can definitely be used. These are my references. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rasika, for such an amazing session.
I have a question, Dr. Parata.
1 minute, sir. I could not see the name of Rasika in the list.
Sir, actually, she was scheduled for the previous session.
Her case number, paper number?
So my paper number is 1720.
1720? 20. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
So I have a question for Dr. Rasika. As this was a randomized trial, was it a registered trial? Was it registered? And second, how was the sample size calculated for your trial?
Yes, sir, it was a registered trial. And
how did you calculate the sample size?
So,
what is the basis of this sample? Is it based on any previous study?
Yes, a few more studies have been done with a similar sample size. So, yeah,
okay.
Whatever number was collected till then were taken into study. And actually, we tried taking 65 eyes. Amongst them, many were in dropout. So, almost 54 eyes could complete their study till 1 year. So, they were followed up.
So for the chairman, sir, should we mark on this paper? Should we mark on this paper, sir? Should we give marks?
We can give her the marks and we can send the sheet mentioning that she was the speaker of the previous session. And let the authorities decide whether to include that.
I was asking, I am not seeing the name her, of her in list. So where to mark? Where to do marking?
Sir, you can write down the write down below to that mentioning the situation that she has requested to present in our session. And since we had a time, we allowed her. Let the authorities decide whether to include that in award or not.
Sir, total how many, beside her, how many case presentation done?
Actually, till now, there are four has been done from our session and Dr. Rasiya finished fifth. So we still have three or four more, but I think there are
sir,
no.
Sir, may I know another two before the...
Any more speakers from this session? I will repeat the name again. Dr. Radhika, Dr. Vanshaj Rai, Dr. Abhilasha, Dr. Vishnupriya.
Vishnupriya and...
Are they present?
Dr. Respected judges and Dr. Praveen, I from back end myself, Aja, I called them. Say they will be absent, sir, as they are not.
They will not be somebody. Present.
Yeah, they will be absent.
What about the keynote
address?
So far, absentee's name, please. So far, the absentee reported. Name of them?
Praveen, Dr. Praveen, can you please name once again?
Those who have presented the paper, sir, because you joined late, I will repeat the name, those who have presented. The free paper number 1225, Dr. Bhosle has presented first.
Okay.
Then free paper 2177, Dr. Khan presented second. Then free paper 1447, Dr. Balkrishna presented third. And free paper 1836, Dr. Praveen Vashishta present fourth. So these are the only four presentation from our session. Dr. Rasika was from the previous session. And Dr. Mr. Ajay from CSC team, is there going to be a the keynote address? Ajay? Okay, he's not listening.
Ms. Shivani can contact Ajay.
Shivani?
Yes, sir.
Who is going to speak? Who is going to deliver the keynote
address? Mr. Ajay has arrived.
Ajay.
Please tell us, Mr. Ajay, now what do we do
about
the keynote address?
Just a minute. Arun, sir, Partha here.
Arun, oh, Partha, how are you? Sorry, your name was Ajay. I fought.
No, no. So I have one thing to tell you that this is Srinivasan Hall. And in Srinivasan Hall, you're going to get another speaker who is the finalist of the committee one. Okay. That person's result is being tabulated. And he will come into Srinivasan Hall. So after you have finished judging all the papers of this hall, please stay back and he will be logging in within, say, about 10-15 minutes.
But then that occupying. The only request I have is that for our session, there's a little change.
Yes.
We had only four speakers. We have tabulated them.
Okay.
And then we had a fifth speaker from another session, also online right now, Dr. Rasika, taken from Pune. Now, she spoke on laser trabeculoplasty by SMT, and she was in another session where she had the name was given in this session. So we have allowed her to present and we have given her a marking.
Yes.
So how do we coordinate that?
Yes. Now, the marking that you will give will be on the same score sheet that you have marked your session. Okay. So you have to write down the presenter's name, the number, membership number, and give the marks and send the whole with your signature to the number that we have given to you. Is that clear, sir?
Right. So we'll do that in the next half an hour. And yes. In the meantime, we'll wait for your guest note speaker.
Yeah.
I mean, the winner of the previous session.
So you have a little time and the session closes at 10:55. Before that, you will have the speaker coming in from the community one. from community one and community two. Actually, there'll be two speakers. I'm sorry. There'll be two speakers, one from community one and one from community two, who will come in. So these two also you have to adjudge. So I repeat myself once again. So from community one and community two, one each will come into your hall, and you have to adjudge both these and put both of their names with their membership number, and then send it to the
How do we know the membership number? How do we get to know the membership number?
The membership number they will tell. You ask them the
Okay.
Okay.
Another thing is that we wanted to take your advice is that a lot of people have not turned up.
Yeah.
It would be a good idea for tomorrow's session, at least for later sessions, that somebody send a message to all the people and ask them to confirm whether they're appearing or not. Then you can condense the list.
Yeah, sir. That actually has been done, but people sometimes are not bothered.
So is it because people are not registered, so they're not allowed to present, or is there any other
reason? They have not registered, and there's so many other things. But anyway, sir, but thank you so much for your time. And
perfectly. All right. It's been very well done, and I must say, considering the logistics in this, you're doing excellent. So don't worry about it. Hats off to you. And enjoy the conference. And look forward to many more virtual meetings like this. Believe me, this is much better than a live conference. We're sitting in a place safely and doing it.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Sir, congratulations, Sajin. It's going on smoothly.
One suggestion I have, all the people who are missing out on their papers, they should be asked to send the recording in future.
Yeah.
I just did the cake and pie meeting. 100% recording is sent in advance, so that even if the person doesn't show up, the presentation is not affected. Also, you know how serious they are.
Exactly. So, thank you very much. Please carry on. Thank you.
Dr. Partha, very nice.
So, is Dr. Vishesh there or is he less? Praveen Vishesh.
Actually, if there are the speakers,
I'm here only.
Your face is not there. So we let us go with the discussion. They're going to bring two people who are speaking other sessions here. So we have about 10 minutes to pass before they start reading the papers. So one is we have to compute our results. Second thing is that the survey that you have done, I was interested to know, in this survey, you focus on pediatric ophthalmology. You do not focus on vitreo retina and other diseases. What is the reason for that?
Sir, I would like to mention that it is possible to get all the indicators.
Just a minute, can somebody mute the CSC team, please, because there's a lot of disturbance. Please mute the CSC team again. Go ahead.
These pediatric ophthalmology indicators were shown as an example. We can have more than 100 indicators. In fact, the study was funded by Orbis. Orbis mainly worked on pediatric eye care. We have some set of separate portion on pediatric eye care, but they have not been presented. In detail, we can have further information on pediatric eye care beside this.
Dr. Praveen asked, you know, that the future ophthalmologists want to practice will know where to go. But actually, it does not give that demographics because of two reasons. One is that the paying capacity of people may not be there. That is why I was saying if you combine with a vision center, then you don't have to invest everywhere. You know, you save on that. Second thing is the next study that Dr. Praveen does should also include the distribution of equipment, like LASIK lasers. Delhi has 160. When the need is only for 16. So what happens is that people do not get the data and the manufacturers make a fool of the ophthalmologist by saying, if you don't have it, you can't complete your practice. And later on, you find the poor ophthalmologist running around trying to beat the monthly EMIs. So if one had a data, how many of these equipments are available, and if there could be a sharing process, believe me, with limited amount, you can do a lot more.
So for equipment,
we have two lectures left. I think maybe we should finish that two lectures and then.
But where are they? You said they will take 10 minutes for them to come.
Dr. Ray Bhaskar, are you supposed to present? Dr. Aditi, these are the two who logged in now, just now. Are you going to present Dr. Ray and Dr. Aditi?
No, sir. We are from the next session. We are just checking the login.
Okay, Dr. Bhaskar.
So he's from our session, next session. We are very sorry, but we were just checking the login.
Yeah, we have been told that there will be two more speakers which are not in our list. So are they present here now?
No, he said it'll take 10 minutes because they're compiling the thing. They have not yet declared the winners.
Okay.
That's why I was passing the time.
Okay.
So Dr. Vishesh, carry on. You were telling us something about the equipment.
Yeah, actually, in 2004 to 2006, we did a detailed survey, and that included all the equipment also. But more important is availability of functional equipment and whether they're using it or not. Unfortunately, that was not a very successful attempt. So in this survey, we have just included equipment related to pediatric eye care. The rest of the equipment component was not included. And in 2006-07, the total number of reporting centers were hardly 2,000. This time, we are very lucky that we are able to get data from 8,000 institutes. This is a big achievement. This is almost representing the actual status in our country. This is the first time we have got such a good response.
You see, because if we can regulate the economic aspect of it, it will make life much easier, because doctors are over-investing. Now with COVID, you've seen that the patient can disappear at the flick of a finger, and people who buy this equipment can be in the soup because the payments are very, very severe.
You are right, sir. In fact, such kind of survey should also be conducted. Instead of including all institute, we can select some part of the institute, especially the tertiary level centers, where we find more number of equipments. So tertiary level hospitals, they can be covered. You know, but in such kind of data, there are always some kind of gaps are there, because this is as per the information provided by that institute. And it is very difficult to confirm everything from that institute.
Correct.
For example, more than 1,000 institutes, they have reported that they are providing tertiary level facility, the private institute. I have a doubt, actually. We need to actually define what is tertiary care. It's a training center where ophthalmologists are getting training. That is defined as tertiary level centers.
Also, also we need to define the allied services in the centers, such as the anesthesia service.
It is very well defined. As far as eye care allied sciences in India is concerned, only optometrists and ophthalmic assistant, they are the actual. If nurses and OT technicians, they are just a support, they have not been included as per NPCB. So we have got data of optometrist and ophthalmic assistant in this program, not other group of staff. Right?
Dr. Praveen, can you share with the link for that study? You mentioned the link is available, the data is available online.
Yes, sir. I will share this in WhatsApp group. I just want that each and everyone should use this Vision Atlas. You can download the tables, format, everything from this one. So this is so useful that for the planner also, as well as for the community also, everything is available in relation to National Blindness Survey, National Diabetes Retinopathy Survey, whatever we have done last 5 years. People ask for reports, and that reports are kept in their cabins. They don't even read it. But now this is totally visible, and we are the first one after IAPB Vision Atlas, because India is the leading now in developing such kind of Vision Atlas, and it is so comprehensive. Entire National Blindness Survey data, National Diabetic Retinopathy Survey data, and this HR data is available in Vision Atlas. I'm really thankful.
Yes. One question, after this COVID, the Prime Finance Minister announced a lot of incentives and benefits for the healthcare, mostly for oxygen plants being set up in hospitals and for setting up hospitals and COVID centers. Any direct impact on ophthalmology centers as such in these new policies are not yet clear?
Sir, personally, as an advocacy measures, what we will try that the ophthalmology center should not be affected with this kind of things. In fact, this will be our major attempts to Ministry of Health and also through NPCB, that eye care services, the targets, we should keep a specific. In fact, sir, I would like to share that we have submitted a proposal to PMO for cataract surgical services, and the budget is not 500 crore something, it is around 10,000 crore rupees. That cataract surgical services should be promoted. So we are utilizing that COVID has affected our eye care services, and we need to eliminate such important disease, the blindness due to cataract, which is still the leading cause of blindness. So I hope that if that proposal is accepted, then we'll target for nearly 1.2 crore surgeries per year in our country. Let's see whether it is feasible or not. Right?
In the meantime, I'm going offline to compute the results and send them, and I'll see when the start and come online again. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Praveen. Nice meeting you. Thank you, Dr. Goyal.
Dr. Praveen, your study was really nice and it's wonderful and it's very useful.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.